Hello, everybody. How are you doing? So, my name is State. Today I'll be hosting the Evolution Chamber. In case you're unfamiliar with who I am a American StarCraft II pro gamer training in Korea. I'm originally from California, the San Francisco Bay Area. I moved to Korea to begin training with Team StarTail in 2012 for just a couple of months for the, what was it? The WCS Global Finals in Shanghai. And about a year later, in November of 2013, I decided to come back. I began training with FoYu for a number of months. I think I was there for about 6 months until the team eventually disbanded. Then I joined Prime. I trained with them for a while, eventually moved on to Axiom, and as of last year, I began practicing on my own out here in Korea, and I'm looking to continue training in Korea for at least the upcoming year. So that's a little bit about me. Today, I am a Protoss player, and so today's Evolution Chamber episode will mostly be about Protoss. What I would like to focus on today with you is a gateway-centric style of PvT. Life story incoming. Yeah, a gateway-centric style of PvT. And this is one thing that I decided when I was trying to think of what would be the best option for the Evolution Chamber. I was deciding whether it would be fun to explore some really interesting PvT styles, PvP styles, or PvZ styles. And I eventually did decide on PvT, although it was a really close decision for me between PvZ and PvT. But I feel like the way that most players outside of Korea play PvT, typically it's usually a very passive style, focusing on disruptors or that kind of gameplay. And it's really different, the gameplay that I do myself in Korea and a lot of other Korean pro gamers, which is a disruptor-less style of PvT, a gateway-centric style of PvT that focuses on expanding aggressively, doing a lot of harassment, and never really teching up to disruptors, more staying on just gateway units with heavy upgrades, lots of expansions, and using Psystorm as the primary form of AoE. And for me personally, I find it to be a much more enjoyable style of gameplay as opposed to the disruptor style, but I also find it to be a lot more effective in many situations, particularly against Terran players that are very good at control. Because one thing that I've noticed in my own gameplay is when I do try to go for disruptors, even if I feel like I'm playing very well in my disruptors, if I'm getting my good shots off or that kind of thing, it's actually so difficult to land really solid hits against a very good Terran player, one that's going to be able to control their units effectively. They'll kind of kite the same way they would against Charge Zealot, Archon, or something like that in Heart of the Swarm, where you could never really get a good engagement off on them. And so for that reason, I found it to be very successful for me. I've also found it to be a very entertaining style to play. Like I said, it's really fun expanding aggressively, being able to do multi-prong attacks and that kind of thing. And also, because you're focusing mostly on gateway units as the core of your army, even things like drop defense are a lot more easy because you don't really need to rely on disruptors, for example, to defend, say, a Doom Drop, because the army composition that you're going to be using in the main battle is the same one that you're going to be using when you're actually defending attacks from the Terran player as well. And let's see if we can get everything correct. There was a patch recently, and so some of these game settings might be a little bit off just because of that patch. So give me one moment. And if you guys have any questions about this gameplay style or myself or anything like that, feel free to save them until after this replay, and also until the end of the show. Typically, what you see, oh god, mirrors. What you see over here on my overlay is typically where chat would go, but since this is not on my own host channel, I won't be able to see it in OBS, so I will read off those questions and that kind of thing. And also, at the end of the show today, I will also have the replay pack available for you guys to download. So, let's see. You know, life bars, control groups, flyer helper, mouse wheel zoom. Okay, this should be good. So this first replay that we're going to be watching together, it's a little bit long. These first couple of replays are going to be a little bit long, and the main thing that I'm going to be trying to show you guys is how this style works out in the most typical situation. There is one more thing that I would like to take care of, excuse me. I'm sorry, all the settings get reset whenever there's a patch, because you have to open the replays in like an offline mode kind of thing. Is that everything? Playing background. Continuous music playing background. So most games that you're going to be playing... Oh, everything is a little bit too loud. Let me bring this volume down a little bit more. I'm sorry about that. The default settings always throw me off a little bit. So what I'm going to be focusing on today... At first, we're going to be looking at... Ooh, is this still a little bit too loud? Can somebody tell me in chat, is this a little bit too loud? Testing... Oh, God. Let me turn off. No. Hello, I should have that off, though. Is the game sound a little bit too loud? It's a little bit hard for me to check. Let's try bringing volume down a little bit more. Because it does feel very loud for me, but it's a little bit hard to tell on my end. My primary focus for today, the first three replays I would like to analyze with you guys, will be primarily macro-oriented play. We're going to talk about games where we're getting up to 3, 4, potentially even 5 bases. And this is probably going to be typical for when you're playing this kind of style, because it's a very hard style to break, but it's also a very hard style, as we're going to talk about later, to actually end the game. And this is actually extremely loud for me for whatever reason. Let me try bringing this down a little bit more and fixing it on OBS. It looks like some people in chat are also saying it's a little bit loud. I'll be reading the chat, like on GTV. It sounds better now. Yeah, it's had too loud. I'll be reading the chat and like on TV, not on the one on my own host channel. I always hate whenever these patches roll out and all the sounds get reset. And please ignore the chat. But as I was saying, as far as this style goes, the typical game that you're going to play is going to end up probably stabilizing and going into the mid-game on 3, 4, or 5 bases. Just because this style, as I was saying, it's very hard for you to end the game. And I'm going to explore that a little bit later as a Protoss player, because Gateway-centric armies, when you're saying pushing a Terran's 4th base with planetaries, or even pushing it to the 3rd base with Terran's city, bunkers, SCVs being pulled into reinforcements right here, it's a little bit difficult to end the game aggressively. But likewise, unlike disruptors, which if you miss a couple of shots and your opponent pushes you, it can be really difficult to actually defend any kind of push. With a gateway kind of army, it's always going to be consistent damage. You're never really going to miss like a stalker shot, for example. You're always going to be able to do enough damage and be able to defend with overcharge and so forth. Please ignore the chat. But for the most part, your games will be ending up going into this kind of macro stage. And so typically, when we open like this, we're going to be going for something like what we did in this game, which is a 19 Nexus off of a 16 gateway, 16 gas, and then a core. This game, the core is a little bit later than usual after for the second gas. This might have been more in the experimental phase when I was first beginning to do this gameplay style. But gonna send out the probe, see exactly what the Terran is doing. One of the primary reasons why I am sending this probe is because typically if Terran players open for a Reaper first and then go into the reactor, you will be able to do some pylon aggression and actually kill the depots and even the reactor on the barracks if you're fortunate enough or your Terran opponent miscontrols in some way. But whenever you see something like this, a Marine first and then straight into a reactor, typically that's not going to be able to pan out that way for you. But the way that you're going to play this style is typically either Twilight or Robo first. In this game, I do opt for the Twilight. And that's going to be for something like Blink or Adept Attack Speed. Either option is very good. There are a lot of different flavors you can go with this army composition, as we're going to see later in this game. In the meantime, our Terran opponent is going for 3 CC. We, of course, do not know this. And so, in the meantime, we're just building some Adepts. Oh, I do talk so much. And so, let's see. This game, we are going for Resonating Glaives. As I said before, even if you're going for a typical gameplay, which is going to be either with a Warp Prism for Adept Harassment, or even just Warp in Blink Stalkers and begin pressuring the front, because typically Terran players, if they're not going to be going for a really aggressive kind of style of gameplay, they will be going for something like a fast 3rd CC. Maybe not this quick, but still relatively fast. You will be able to do some kind of good pressure with either of these options. And typically, as you're going to see later in the day when we do explore this kind of army composition that we're going to go for, which again is gateway-centric, this is typically the way you will see them open up. Either with a Twilight Council and then a Robo, or a Robo and then a Twilight Council, depending on whether you want to hit early with 4 Adepts before the upgrade, or if you want to do an attack speed upgrade, and then timing push, that kind of thing. Both options are very good. We will also be exploring a little bit later Stargate openings with this style, which will be a lot of fun, but here we have 3 Adepts already, just playing very defensively. There's not too much you can do very early in the game. Posturing our pylons defensively. this pylon placement is very good for defending, say, Widowmine aggression or anything like that in the early game, having one pylon in the mineral line. And once the Warp Prismal is out, we're going to warp in one more Adept off this gateway. We're going to push out with these four Adepts and the Warp Prism and try and get some economic damage done. In the meantime, let's see exactly where we're at. Right now it's about 4 minutes and 30 seconds. That's typically around the timing that the Warp Prism will complete if you go Trilling and then Robotics. Otherwise, it may be a little bit later, say, or a little bit earlier, say 4 minutes and 10 seconds or 4 minutes and 20 seconds if you opt for the Robo first. The added perk of this is, again, being able to get the attack speed upgrade very quickly. And so as soon as these Adepts reach the opponent's side of the map, typically, you're going to be able to have the Adept attack speed upgrade finished if you're going for the Twilight Council first, as we see here, and that makes them so much more effective at actually killing SCVs. In the meantime, we've gone up to 3 gateways, 4 gases. We're going to be warping in Stalkers at home defensively because, again, we're not going to really be needing those warp-ins with our Warp Prism. We're just going to be using these 4 Adepts to try and get some harassment done. And these Stalkers back at home will be able to defend things like, in this case, our opponent's going for Cloak Banshee, which is a little bit unusual. Actually, not actually researching Cloak, but Banshee, which is a little bit unusual. Typically, the kind of aggression that you would see around this stage of the game would be Widowmine drop with Marines or something to that effect. Or even a Liberator, if your Terran opponent's going to rush something out like that. And so it's important to be able to warp in Stalkers like this back at home while you're doing this aggression. And then beginning Observer production. The Robo, like I said earlier, we're going Disruptorless PVT. Robo is primarily going to be used for Observers and Immortals. The count that I like to go for with the Observers is 4. You might want to go for something such as like 2 or 3 or even up to something like 5, which is a little bit too greedy in my opinion. But any number of that is good. Just a Warp Prism, begin Observers, and take a third base. And the reason why we're able to take a third base, and it's a little bit fortunate that our Terran opponent is actually going with a Banshee right here. One of the reasons why it's extremely safe to take this third base, which feels very quick to many players. But we're on 3 gateways, we're completely safe against harassment. The Mothership Core and these 3 pylons back in our main base can defend any kind of Widowmine drop. If a Widowmine drop comes in, just straight 3 or 4 Widowmines, or even Widowmines and Marines, they won't actually be able to damage the mineral line as long as we react effectively and respond very quickly with our overcharge. In the meantime, our Stalkers that are natural should be able to deflect any medevacs that come in here, or in this case, a Cloak Banshee. And one of the added bonuses of going for a style like this with a very fast Warp Prism and Adepts is not only does this give you the option to do a lot of harassment to your Terran opponent, but also when you open up with a Warp Prism like this, you're 100% able to, in almost all situations, pin the Terran back in their base until they have enough army to, one, defend your Warp Prism, and then also be able to push out on the map. And so they can either do that with static defense, such as having missile turrets here, here, and here, or even some Widowmines in a bunker, or alternatively, if they're just going to be able to use their army, having all these Marines back at home. If our Terran opponent were to push out with these Marines, it might actually be a little bit difficult for us to defend, but realistically, that is not an option for the Terran player until their Marine count is significantly higher. And that is just because these 4 Adepts, with their attack speed upgrade and the Warp Prism, have so much potential, especially with another warp-in of 3 more Adepts or 3 more Stalkers or anything like that, have so much potential to do so much economic damage that even if our Terran opponent were to take the risk and move out right now with these Marines and try and pressure this third base, even if you were to take that risk and be able to deny the third base, the economic damage that the Terran player would take from the Adepts and the Warp Prism would put us in a very advantageous position as the Protoss player. And so, back at home, after the Adept harassment has begun, we're researching Blink. Again, we're going for a really gateway-centric army style, and so for us, getting our Adept attack speed upgrade, getting Blink, and getting Charge are our 3 primary concerns with the Twilight Council. We'll be chrono-boosting those 3 upgrades out in almost every single one of these games. And our Robo, again, right now we're at 2 Observers. We have 1 Observer here because, again, we're afraid of the Cloak Banshee, but typically the Observer placement we're going to be going for is something here, something here, something here when we take our 4th base, and then eventually an Observer here, because on this map, this location for medevacs going into the natural is actually really dangerous. And so, eventually, once we do have our full Observer coverage, we'll be able to have 1 more Observer here to actually keep an eye on when the Terran opponent's going to be taking their 3rd base, their 4th base, and where they're going to be moving out aggressively. And so right now, Terran opponent is defending very well. He has a bunker, he has these Marines positioned well. He is a little bit vulnerable, it is natural, but we don't know that currently. Excuse me. And he also saw a Warp Prism on this side of the map, so he knows. He's actually patrolling with the Liberator. He knows that he's safe and is natural, at least for now. So in the meantime, we're going ahead and building 2 more forges, adding our gateway counts because our economy is going to be increasing a lot once we get our Nexus up here, and building a few more pylons in a defensive position at our third base. The Banshee hasn't really been able to get too much harassment done. I'm not sure whether he poked into the natural, but if he had poked into the natural, this observer and these five stalkers would easily deflect it. And as he's now poking into the main base, these pylons, again, with an observer, even though he doesn't have cloak, even if he did it, he wouldn't really be able to do too much damage. And in the same position, we're again trying to get a little bit of damage done. Our primary concern with this, because our opponent is playing very safely, is one to deny the third base, because it's very similar to in Heart of the Swarm as a Protoss player. The role's kind of reversed, and that, like, Heart of the Swarm, just as an example, as a Protoss player, if your Terran opponent is playing very aggressively, it wouldn't really be the issue that you're not able to defend the third when you expand quickly. The issue would be whether you would have enough units to defend the third and also everything else. And that's kind of the problem that's posed for the Terran player in this situation, is we have a Warp Prism out of the map, and just as I was talking before, because the Warp Prism is alive, our Terran player knows he won't be able to push out on the map and attack us, because he won't be able to defend at home. And in the same way, he won't actually be able to lift his command center and saturate his third base effectively until he has enough army units out, because of the same problem. He'll be spread a little bit too thin, it'll be a little bit too hard for him to defend effectively on his three bases. So this Warp Prism, even if we don't get a lot of indirect damage done, which in this case we killed a couple of probes, we're trying to do a little bit of economic damage with these adepts, so they're realistically we won't be able to get too much. He's positioned very safely with a bunker here. He has Marines in his main mineral line, siege tank in another bunker. We're probably not going to be able to get too much direct damage done. However, we are able to do a lot of indirect damage in terms of, one, denying our opponent taking the third base very quickly, and also denying our opponent map control. So these adepts now trying to do a little bit of harassment. Notice, as I said before, we're still upgrading our gateway count. We don't really get too many SCVs. It looks like maybe 6 or 7 might have gone down. Actually, up to 9. One of those might have been a scouting SCV. Who knows? But those 7 adepts, sending 3 into the main mineral line and 3 into the natural mineral line. Even though we did lose the Warp Prism, at this point in the game, when the opponent's bunkers are, not bunkers, our opponent's barracks are getting up, we're actually in the position where they're going to be able to defend effectively. And so being able to trade these out for, say, 9 SCVs, or maybe 7 or 8 SCVs, depending on how many we're scouting and being lost that way, is actually a very good position for us, even though we do lose the Warp Prism. And I'm certain that will be remade very shortly. In the meantime, our third base is now up. We're getting our 2 forge upgrades. We're going up to 3 and now 5 gateways and beginning immortal production. Now that we have, let me guess, 4 observers. One here, one here, one here. And this one's going to that position I was telling you about before. It's a spot for drops coming to the third base in the natural. Once you take your third base, and this is one thing a lot of people on my stream are always curious about, is how we're going to be appropriating our Chrono Boost. Typically when forges are up, I like to begin Chrono Boosting our 2 forge and our Robo for production. Because just adept attack speed and blink, or charge zealot and blink, are both two very good ways of getting into the mid game. It's not exactly necessary to get all 3 of them very quickly. It's very good for our mid game army, but in the early game, and I still would consider this the early game, just getting 2 of those is enough. So we're up to almost full 3 base saturation, immortal stalkers, and our opponent, just because of our defensive posture, isn't really able to get too much damage done. He may try, but in this position of the game, we are really safe. We're also very close in supply as well. A little bit of indirect damage being done here, but again, getting blink very quickly. Blink, if you go for this kind of opening, will typically be done at the time where Liberator Crest is going to start like this. We're able to deny that and go back to mining, and likewise, we're able to deflect the Banshee harassment very well. And so right now, at about 8 minutes, this is typically where we're going to be at when we do this opening, is we're not going to have a very high gateway count. Even now we're still up to 5. It actually may be a mistake that we hadn't gone up to a higher gateway count, because notice our third base kicked in. We actually have a lot of money right now, although we will be starting 2-2 very quickly. At 8 minutes, we're at 1-1 upgrades. Psystorm has begun. We almost have all 3 of our Twilight Council upgrades. We're beginning mortar production. We have a very good healthy observer count of 4, which allows us to have not only very good vision on the map, but very good map awareness in terms of if our opponent is going to be playing aggressively, we can actually begin in the future doing counterattacks with Warp Prisms and that sort of thing. But also just being in a very defensive posture and able to get up our third base very effectively. Keep in mind that our opponent did go for a very fast third CC, and even though our third expansion was much later than our opponent's third CC was, because of our opening doing a little bit of indirect damage with the Warp Prism, getting our upgrades out very quickly, and our tech being as high as it is, we're actually in a very good position, even in supply count, which is quite impressive even considering that we're going up for 2 forge. And our opponent's still on just 1 engineering bay. Oh, he did actually go for 2. Oh, I guess I was wrong in that guard. That might be one of the reasons why the supplies are quite so close. typically you would expect going for this kind of army composition, building really expensive units such as Immortals, Blinkstalkers, High Templar, and Sentries. The Terran player that's only building Marines and Marauders, for the most part, is going to be a little bit ahead on supply. And so let's now speed up a little bit as we go into the mid-game. We know through our observer coverage that there's no pressure really going on. We also know through intuition, and have we actually seen this? No, but through intuition, when we did see the 3rd Command Center very quickly, we know that they're going to be set up in a defensive position here. We're going to go ahead and take a 4th base. And this is one thing that I very much enjoy about going for a gateway-centric style, is remember how I was talking again about one of the main issues when you're expanding very aggressively, even if you're just taking your 3rd base quickly, is not specifically whether you can defend the 3rd base well. It's also whether you can defend the other bases, whether you're going to be spreading yourself too thin. One thing that I really enjoy about going for a gateway-centric army like this is how good it actually performs in low numbers, because all of our gateway units are going to be upgraded. We're going to be relying on things such as Stystorm and having Templar in our main base and our Natural in our 3rd base like that later to defend drop harassment. As opposed to going for a Disruptor style, we're able to expand a lot more aggressively because we're able to defend our bases a lot more effectively. One, because we don't really need the Robo to be committing all of its time to building Disruptors. We can afford to get the Observers out very quickly, and if they die, to rebuild them, because our Robo production time isn't quite as crucial. But also, again, because our gateway count is going to naturally be a little bit higher, we're adding our gateways now. And also because, like I said, our gateway count units are going to be much more effective, even in low numbers, against bio and drops. It also adds the added bonus of us being able to position ourselves a little bit more aggressively and get a little bit of map control. Realistically, these stalkers aren't going to be able to do too much damage, but neither do they actually pose a threat of dying, just because with Link they're very mobile. We have complete map control when we do this kind of opening, at least to the mid-game against our Terran opponent. So now we're adding up to 7 gateways. At this point in the game, it was when in Korea it was very popular to get a fusion core quickly, and then on 3 bases try and deny a mining base such as this one, or this one, with a ranged Liberator, and so for that reason I am actually going up to the Stargate very quickly. Later in the game this will be used for Tempest, but right now it'll just be for one Void Ray, if the situation arises where they do go for that kind of army composition. And this is also one push that a lot of Protoss players will tell me that they have issues with on my own personal stream, is in the mid-game when you're trying to take a 4th base, or even if you're just on 3 bases, and the Terran does a push either with Siege Tanks and Liberators, or just Bios in mine, the very first push that gets either from around 9 minutes to 10 minutes is typically the hardest one to deal with. And again, remember how I was talking about if you're going for a really tech-focused army with a gateway count, even though we have a lot of gateways, we're spending most of our money instead of warping in units, we're warping in additional gateways. We're going up to a very high gateway count because our 4th base is going to be finished very soon. And we're also spending all of our excess gas on Templar. We have 6 Templar, which is a very high count. We have 4 Immortals. We have a good number of Stalkers, which are very expensive units for their supply. Exactly as expensive as an Immortal for its supply. We're getting up to a Stargate. We're already on 2-2, just as our opponent's going for 2-2. And we're also getting things such as Dark Shrine. And so, in this position, our army cost is actually very similar to the Terrans, although we're very far behind in supply, just because, again, our army is a lot more tech-focused. However, this isn't such a scary position, as long as you know exactly where your opponent is pushing you, which is, again, is important with the observer coverage, and also just to have the map awareness to be able to meet them out on the map, particularly against Siege Tank compositions and Liberator compositions, especially on maps like this one, where it's mostly one main attack path that is going to be occurring throughout most of the game, as opposed to maps like Orbital Shipyard, where there will be like different varied ways you can go ahead and attack the 3rd base and 4th base. It's really important to actually meet the Terran army out in the middle of the map. And so while this may look like a really scary position in the group play, just judging by the supplies, again, if you look at the army supply, we're down about 1,000 minerals, but we're up about 1,000 gas, and we have really good army composition against pretty much anything Terran can throw at us in this stage of the game. Whether it's going to be Liberators, we would warp in more Stalkers, whether it's going to be something like this with Siege Tanks, we'll warp in more Charge Zealots. We have the flexibility with our style to be able to react exactly to the unit composition that our Terran opponent throws at us. And so we'll see exactly how this fight goes. A little bit unfortunate for the Terran player that he's not able to kill this Observer, even with 2 scans, one on the main army and then one on the Observer. But again, even though this is quite a bit scary of a position, when we eventually do go for the engagement, Guardian Shield, these Zealots now have 4 armor with Guardian Shield. The Marines, even with their attack upgrade, are only going to be doing 3 damage a shot against these. And likewise, this Immortals are going to be very effective in terms of breaking down the Marauder counts, breaking down the Siege Tanks. If you're wondering why I didn't go for Adepts in this situation, it's because Adepts tend to clump a little bit more against Siege compositions. And when you're playing against siege tank compositions, you don't really want to be comping against the AoE of the siege tank. Whereas when you're a charge zealots, the siege tanks are going to be attacking the units that are in the front. In this case, those are the zealots. And a lot of the splash damage is actually going to be dealt on the bio as well. So it's a little bit of friendly fire going down in the Terran army, as opposed to just strictly being on the Protoss. So here, we're going for engagement, landing some Psy Storms. There aren't ghosts, so we don't really need to worry about too much about clumping our army. And it's actually a pretty resounding victory. Again, remember, at the beginning of this fight, we were behind almost 30 supply, but the army composition that we have, even fighting before 2-2 is done, which is honestly a mistake on my part, even fighting before 2-2 is done, we're able to get a really resounding victory here on the middle of the map. And part of that was because we caught the Terran player a little bit off guard and they were a little bit clumped. But even then, notice we also have, how many? Almost two more Storms. Whoa, look at the click box on this. Look at the click box on this Templar. We have two more Storms on this Templar. We have one more Storm on this Templar. We have another Guardian Shield, and we retained our Immortal count. So even if that fight wasn't quite as good for us, we still definitely have the tools we would need to be able to continue and win the fight later on. And so here we are, successfully defending the Terran push on 3 base. They're only just now beginning their 4th base, and we're already fully saturated on minerals at our 4th base. If we look at the mineral income, typically you would expect Protoss to be a little bit behind because of mules, but we're actually a little bit ahead, which is a very comfortable position to be in, especially considering our infrastructure. We're on 2 forge with 2-2 completed. We're going to be able to start 3-3 very quickly. We have 14 gateways. These 4 haven't quite morphed yet, they just finished. I think I was a little bit sidetracked by that. And we also have a very healthy immortal count, already up to 5 immortals, and we still have very good observer coverage on the map. This observer should be over here, but even then, that little tiny mistake, we do have incredibly good vision and map control after winning this fight. And if you remember earlier in the game, I was talking about how difficult it is to actually break a Terran player with this composition. This game specifically was from very early, maybe about a week into me practicing this style. This is from like the end of December, and I've been spending a lot more time on developing this style, but this is one of the best macro-oriented replays that I have to showcase it just in a very simple way. It's kind of like a clean cut dry form of exactly how this opening should work, ideally in your own games. This is when, even for me as a Protoss player, I wasn't exactly sure how easy or how difficult it was to kill a Terran player with this composition. And so for me, from now on, and you're going to see again later in the replays, I'll continue to highlight this. For me, the name of the game, after you actually get into this stage, where you're happily macroing on 4 or 5 bases, or even if we had taken this base a little bit more slowly, we would still be at a good economic edge. Even if this base was 1 or 2 minutes later, because again, like, the Terran player is just now, like, their 3rd command center isn't even, or their 4th command center isn't even complete. The objective becomes less in the mid game about actually ending the Terran player, and a lot more about denying the 4th base. Because if you deny the 4th base, Terran players, their big economic perk is that they have the mule, which allows them to mine a lot more efficiently, even with even worker counts. Like right now, we're on 4 bases. Our Terran player is on 3 bases. They're only mining from 3 mineral lines. And they have significantly less workers than we have. But again, the income is actually... Oh, okay. Well, maybe we caught them right before the mules expired. Yeah. Okay, that's what happened. I was gonna say that's a little bit out of whack. There are 4 mules that could be called down right now, and each mule mines at about 4 or 5 workers income. So this is a little bit more skewed. If you remember before, we were a little bit ahead on economy, not quite this much. But the one problem is the mules allows the Terran player to mine a lot more effectively, but also it's gonna force them to mine out a lot more quickly. And so in this case, if you look at the Terran player, he's only on 2 mineral patches in his main base. We're still on 4, which may look like it's a very small difference, but when that also begins taking place in the natural, notice like 120 minerals, 250, even the close mineral patches are mining out exactly as quickly, or almost exactly as quickly as the far mineral patches, just because that's where Terran is going to be dropping the mules. Whereas if you look at us, we're at 730, 265, 815, 600. This one did mine out. Maybe a little bit of missaturation there. But notice our high yield mineral patches have so many more minerals than even the high yield mineral patches of the Terran player. And so if we're able to deny the 4th base of the Terran, or even delay it for a significant amount of time, we're able to just completely overwhelm them in macro. Because this army composition that we go for, until we get Tempests out, in the late game, it's not quite as effective as, say, a Disruptor army composition would be. But in the early and mid game, especially when you're talking about economically, because it allows you to take your bases more quickly, it is so much more powerful. Simply because we're always going to be consistent with our damage. We always have the opportunity to counterattack very effectively. We don't need to worry about the cooldown on the disruptors. And it's also very stable in that even we never run the risk of, say, again, if you go for a disruptor composition, you may miss a disruptor shot and then just end up losing a fight because of that one crucial disruptor miss. So as I was saying, you're going to see me push into this position, and it actually will not be the best engagement for me. We actually might fall a little bit behind following this, because we don't really have much of a buffer in this situation. We are killing a good number of Liberators. We're trading pretty effectively with the Terran. We're still quite ahead on resources lost. But again, imagine in the same position if I'd waited for one or two more full warpins and focused on denying the fourth base. Imagine what a much better position that would have been in. And so while this fight, again, looks like it's very bad for us, and it was admittedly very bad for us, if you consider exactly how effective it would have been if we had these units and these units, and even some of the units, oh, we don't haven't quite warped them in our main base yet, but even all this money spent on warping in with a warp prism or even just sending units across the map to deny the fourth base, imagine what a much better position this would have been for us. But even after a miscue like that, again, we're going for a really high-tech army, and we're significantly ahead in supply even after such a bad engagement, just because we're able to expand a lot more quickly. Even our upgrades are a lot more quick now. Remember that our Terran player also went for 2 Engineering Bay, whereas we went for 2 Forge. We were even for quite some time, but this constant chrono boost on the Forges, we're already up almost by a full minute. No, significantly more than a full minute, almost 2 full minutes against a Terran player. And so now we're kind of in this awkward spot where we really want to deny the fourth base of the Terran, but it's a little bit challenging just because we did throw away quite a few Immortals. I think 3 and a significant number of Stalkers and Archons there. But again, this is one of the early days of this style. Learn from my mistakes if you go for this composition. This is a much more what it should look like. Imagine if we waited for 1 or 2 more minutes, we would have been able to do a push like this and actually break the Terran much more early. There is some counterattack going on over here, but realistically, this army, with their economic advantage, and also having 3-3 now, all these Templar, all these Immortals, all these Archons, it's such an effective army, and it's so easy to actually finish breaking the Terran player on fourth bases if you dominate the mid-game as we did in this situation. Anyway, this is the first replay. You can imagine how the next few minutes go. I do want to get into more games today, so we will be ending this one, but this is kind of a very simple introduction to exactly how the unit composition plays out in the mid-game PVT. And I'm going to go ahead and check out on chat right now. Let's see. Thinks it comes a bunch. There's no ghosts. There's not a big deal. Yeah, it's not quite too a big deal because there are no ghosts, but a little bit sloppy, you know. Hello, Gemini. Are there any Terran timings before 10 minutes that are scary? There are some timings, such as Widowmine drops or proxy factories, that kind of thing, that could be difficult to deal with, but it's no different than if you're going against, say, if you're going for any other composition, because typically timings that are going to hit, specifically when you're talking about 10 minutes, you're talking about things that are going to be hitting the third base for the most part, but once you get to that position, it's actually very safe to go for this composition. Whenever you're going to deal with pressure that's going to be difficult to hold on to, it's going to be very early in the game. And that is because, again, the composition that you go for, particularly a gateway style with Blink or Adept Attack Speed in Robo early, not even going into Disruptors, just going into Gateway Army, it's really stable once you're up to 3 or 4 bases. So around 10 minutes, there's no timing that's particularly scary. It's mostly in the early game timings that will be scary, like Proxy Factories for, the sounds get so loud every time I go into this default. Jesus Christ, 100%. Let's try and bring this back down, maybe to something like 10. Continuous music playing background. I'm sorry, this is just because of the patch recently. Messes things up a little bit. But those scary early game timings play out very similar to the way they would go against, even if you're going for a disruptor composition. Because once again, it's going to be the circumstance where, like, it doesn't exactly matter whether you're going for Disruptors or Gateway-centric army, because the timing's going to hit before you're actually going to make the full commitment to either of those. And so it just plays out similar to the way it would in the early game. And as far as like the mid game, closer to like 6 minutes to 10 minutes, I would argue that it's actually significantly safer going for the gateway style as opposed to the disruptor style, specifically because imagine, it may be a little bit hard to visualize, but imagine you taking a third base aggressively, or even non-aggressively, just taking a third base at a normal timing in PBT with disruptors. That critical moment when you have only one or two disruptors out and Terran does their first push, excuse me, if you miss your first one or two disruptor shots, and then the Terran player pushes before the cooldown of the disruptors is completed, you're in a very dire position because most of your early game DPS is going to come from those disruptors. Some of it will come from, like, if you build one or two immortals. Some of it will come from your adepts and your overcharge, but you're mostly relying on the disruptors. Whereas with the gateway units, you never run the risk of missing disruptor shots or anything like that. It's a lot more flexible and a lot easier to defend in a variety of situations. I'm going to take one or two more questions before we get into this replay, which is a lot more about expanding aggressively. Hello State, thanks for this stream. Questions. Can you explain a little bit about scouting with the first probe? What different units buildings mean and what are your actions would be? So when you're scouting with the first probe, and this is true for most PBT styles as opposed to strictly going for this, because again, in the early game, like when you're scouting with your probe, you're not really deviating so much going for a gateway-centric army versus going for a disruptor-based army. It's going to be a very generic Protoss opening off of, like, for example, a one-gate fast expand or something like that. And there is one thing that particularly does stand out, is if you do even a later scout, say after your Nexus as opposed to after your gateway, you should be able to scout whether it's going to be a Reaper and then a Reactor, or just straight Reactor, or just bringing them in a Reactor. And if it is a Reaper and Reactor, as we're going to see later in the day, when I analyze more aggressive openings, if the Terran opening is Reaper and then Reactor, you actually have a really great opportunity to do pressure with one pylon building three, or one pylon, one probe building three pylons at the base of the Terran ramp, and overcharging those pylons and then sending Adept Shades into the Terran main base. It's really effective. Besides that, if you're going to be scouting later, there's not too much meaningful information you can get from the scouting probe, but typically you should expect, because of the meta and PVT right now, the Terran player to go for some kind of fast pack replay, because they're going to rely on the Cyclone to defend. Warp Prisms, they're going to want to do some Liberator harassment later in the game, that kind of thing. It's a lot more unusual to play against something like Gaslix Expand or CC First. And one more question. This opponent was going for a Banshee. Proxy, non-proxy. What about, okay, this opponent was going for a Banshee opening. What would you think about a proxy or non-proxy Liberator? I think our main was a bit vulnerable to Liberator harassment. How do you deal with that on this map at best without Stargate? So early game, the first Liberator, if you remember that first replay that I showed you, in the early game, when we sent out the Warp Prism with the four Adepts, we were also warping in Stalkers in our natural mineral line. And those Stalkers are specifically to defend two things for the most part, and those two things are, one, Widowmine drops with Marines, and two, Liberator harassment. Our opponent went for Banshee, which kind of falls under like the blanket, the umbrella of early game starport harassment, but if it had been a Liberator, it would have been very much the same. We already have three or four Stalkers at home that are able to defend against the any kind of, oh Jesus, it's so loud. Did I not save these settings? We had the Stalkers at home to actually defend against that. I really wish. This is just me being, that sounds a little bit better, doesn't it? Maybe still a little bit too loud. I really wish the BattleNet settings would, like, preserve the volume and everything like that when you have to open a replay offline because of the patch. Okay. I'll be taking more questions after this. I'm sorry, we've already spent a couple of minutes answering questions. When we do get to the end of the stream, I am 100% certain I will be able to answer everybody's question. So if you didn't have the opportunity to have your question answered by me specifically after this replay, if you can just hold on to that question until the end of either this upcoming replay or the end of the show, or even after the show, I'm going to be streaming on my own personal channel. If you have any questions, I'm really happy to answer them, so please don't feel too disheartened. I do want to get through a lot of these replays and not spend too much time focusing on questions from the chat. But again, we're going to be able to go through this a little bit more quickly now that we have a baseline of exactly what the style is. We're going to be going for, here we are again, a 19 Nexus. And this was during the stage of the game where, in my own little personal meta, my own personal sphere of gameplay, I'm scouting after 19 Nexus, or not scouting at all, as opposed to going for a Gateway Scout. Recently, I've been gravitating more towards the Gateway Scout because Proxy Barracks has become a lot more popular for Reapers. As a matter of fact, we do see another Reaper in production. Not a proxy, however. But here we are going for our 19 Nexus, our Cybernetics Core. This is a much more typical timing for the Cybernetics Core. Starting our Adept, soon starting our Mothership Core, instead going for Aruba very quickly. And this is one thing that's a little bit scary, and this is one thing that I think I might have learned from this game specifically, is you can afford to delay your Mothership Core and still be safe against Reaper Harassment. However, one thing that's really important to do if you decide to do that is to spend your Chrono Boost on your Adept. Notice my Adept is still about 5 seconds from being done when the Reaper arrives at my main base. If I wanted to get the Robo out very quickly, this is still a completely safe thing to do. However, I should have spent my Chrono Boost on the Adept. So please don't take everything that you see in this gameplay as being absolutely perfect. I'm human and I do make mistakes. In this case, it didn't particularly matter, but you could see that little timing window where you could have done a little bit of economic damage. Maybe not killed a probe, but at least forced me to pull probes off the mineral line. So here we are again. Remember, in the previous game we went for Twilight Council and then Robo. This game we went for Robo and then Twilight Council. And we're very quickly going into a warp prism. We have one Adept here at our ramp. And instead of building more Adepts, we're actually going to be relying on building gateways more quickly to go ahead and do some harassment. If you remember from the first game, we built 3 Adepts out of our main base, or out of our main gateway, and then picked them up in the warp prism. And this game, we'll be warping those Adepts aggressively. And this is a Fane, the Chrono Boosted Adept Attack Speed. Instead, we're actually going for a Dark Templar drop. And if you remember from the first game, I was talking about how useful the Warp Prism is in terms of not only doing economic damage, but also buying time in terms of forcing the Terran player to keep back in their own main base. Even if you open Dark Templar, this is a slightly different flavor of this opening, but it's exactly the same. In that even if you don't get game-ending damage, as you see right now, my Terran opponent is going for turrets. Realistically, the DTs are not going to do very much damage. However, this plays out the exact same way as it would going against going for fast attack speed with your Adepts, in that the risk of the Terran player actually moving out to pressure your third base, which we will be taking very soon, a little bit more quick than we did in the previous replay, the risk of the Terran player moving out is too great for them to be able to justify doing it. And even if they do decide to justify doing it, if you don't lose the Warp Prism and you're mindful of when the Terran player is going to be pushing you, for example, I should be sending an Observer pretty soon. After I'm sure that there's going to be no Widowhine harassment or something like this, I should be sending an Observer to my opponent's third base just to keep tabs on this. Being able to see when your opponent moves out and then move in with a Warp Prism and do some counter harassment is really, really effective. So this is a slightly different flavor. It's always good to keep your Terran opponent not quite exactly sure what you're going to do, and so mixing up your gameplay so you're going to hit the same player on ladder a couple of times in a row. It's always good to have a little bit of different tricks up your sleeve, and so in this case, going through four Stalkers and then warping an Adept and getting a Dark Shrine. Our opponent is playing very safely. He has missile turrets, and so we're not going to be able to get too much damage done, but we're able to preserve all of our Stalkers, do a little bit of damage, look at units lost, pretty even, but we did manage to kill, only one SCV. But, as I said before, this brings us to the same position where the Terran player can't really afford to move out. Even though he went for 3 barracks, if you recall previously, the Terran that we played, the STC, went for 3 CC and then 1-1-1. He had a quick starport. Even when the Terran player has enough units out of these 3 barracks, it becomes a very difficult situation for them to move out just because of the risk of counterattack. And here we are, very bold, because again, we know that we're able to play a little bit aggressively with this. No blink, no attack speed with our Adepts, but just with the vision from the Warp Prism and our Stalkers, able to confidently poke and pressure the Terran while we're taking a third base. In the meantime, getting our 2 forges up. We should still be building observers. Slight misplay by me, not keeping our observer count time. The Robo production time, as I said before, since we're not gonna be building disruptors, it's not quite as crucial. However, it still is really nice to actually be able to optimize that and constantly be building either observers, immortals, or warp prisms. Now on a full 3 base saturation. Our Terran opponent still not moving out, possibly for fear of the Warp Prism. And even this Warp Prism, if we hadn't gone for it, imagine how much more aggressively our Terran player would be able to play. Look at this Bio Army, it would actually be really scary if he were to push us right now. We would be able to defend, but it would be a very scary push. And then in the meantime, also the investment of the Terran player, building 1, 2, 3, 4 turrets, building a bunker in their natural. And remember in the game against the SEC, even building a bunker in the main base. We actually have one here by the rookie at his ramp. Really, really cost effective. Even if it's not direct damage, indirect damage is very good. And this Warp Prism is very crucial in allowing us to get up to the gateway-centric army in the mid-game that we very much want. So here we are now with Blink, beginning Zealot Charge because we're going to be going into Templar Archives. One thing that people ask me a lot on my stream is, when do you want to choose Zealot Charge over Adept Attack Speed? And particularly in the mid-game, when do you want to be warping in Zealots instead of Adepts? And the general rule of thumb that I follow is if you're currently building Templar, it's probably better to build Zealots. Because Zealots cost no gas, you can warp in a lot more Templar and get a lot more damage that way and optimize your army composition. Whereas before you have Templar on the map, Adepts are probably preferable, just because they are a little bit more cost-effective than Zealots, in my opinion. However, again, they do cost gas, and so once you do actually begin going towards Storm, Charge Zealots are probably the way to go. This game, remember, we went Dark Shrine, and then our Twilight Council, so we didn't get Resonating Glaives, and I want to get up the Templar now that we're on three bases. So that is the reason behind me going for Charge Zealots, in case you were curious. And, like remember we said in the previous game, our Observer coverage is very important. If you look at our vision, even though we have no presence on the map with our army, with the exception of our War Prism, we do have very good vision. If our Terran opponent were to go for any kind of dropship harassment, we're almost certainly going to see it. This is a little bit of a dangerous spot. But for the most part, we're very safe. We're also building pylons here to overcharge later in the game because, again, we don't want to spread ourselves too thin. And our Terran player is still playing very defensively. In the meantime, as I said before, going for ground weapons and armor, doing a little bit more harassment with our Adepts. Not quite worth it, as you can tell, but again, same situation as before, where we're going to be a little bit high on supply, but we're building really effective units such as Immortals, we're getting Storm out, we're going to double upgrade, our Terran's only on one engineering bay with plus one ground weapons, and we're able to take a fourth base. And the reason why I'm able to take a fourth base in this position, this is very quick, considering our Terran opponent still hasn't even begun their fourth command center, but if you recall, the way that the army compositions played out in the previous game against the STC was, once we get Psionic Storm out, and we have a healthy count of Immortals, and we have at least two significant upgrades on our Twilight Council, in this case it is the Charge and Blink, we're able to expand a lot more aggressively because our army is so powerful in the mid-game. And this is something that, again, wouldn't be exactly safe to do if you were going for a Disruptor style, but going for a Gateway Heavy style allows us to do this because we're so much more flexible. This army composition is so much more powerful in the mid-game, perhaps not actually ending the game and playing aggressively, but playing defensively, defending drop harassment such as this, defending multi-pronged attacks, anything like that, even one big direct assault like we saw the SDC try and do with siege tanks in the early game previously, we're able to defend just because our army composition is so effective in the early and mid-game. And so for me, when I'm playing on this style, one thing that I really do enjoy doing, and this is one of those situations where we weren't able to react quite quickly enough to avoid taking any damage, but we did get to see this harassment coming under the Observer, so we responded a little bit more quick than the Terran player was expecting. We do actually eventually clear this up, and that's actually a pretty good trade for us. Not the best one, because again, kind of caught out of position with those four medevacs. Honestly, it's a mistake for me not to have pylons here with my Mothership core. But still okay, just because of that Observer coverage and being able to pull units back as soon as we see that. But as I was saying, even situations like this one would be a little bit harder to defend if we hadn't gone for if we'd gone for Disruptors as opposed to a Gateway-centric army. And the name of the game, for the most part, once we get into the mid-game, will be expanding aggressively and eventually denying the fourth base of the Terran player. I'm gonna go back because I didn't mean to move the camera to the fourth base during this fight. Oh god, no. My mouse cursor glitched out. Oh no. Well, this replay is almost over, so we should be okay. But you can actually see how even with without Guardian Shield in this fight, just because of our upgrade advantage, having 2-2 as opposed to just the one attack upgrade of our Terran opponent, even without Guardian Shield and even without, oh god, even without the incredibly effective like Psy Storms, we're still able to push a Terran player back. And with a Warp Prism and doing another aggressive warp in, again, being able to push a Terran player before they actually get their fourth base up. Because remember, we talked previously about how when you're taking a third base and you're taking a fourth base, either you're physically going to be as a Protoss player, as a Terran player, the main concern is whether you're going to be spreading yourself too thin. If I was doing this attack and the Terran player was defending up here at his third base ramp, it would actually be a significantly easier hold for him than actually trying to secure this fourth base. But when you're able to expand really aggressively with this kind of gateway army, gateway-centric army in as a Protoss player, it kind of puts the pressure on the Terran player because they don't want to fall into the trap that, again, in the previous game, the SDC didn't really expand aggressively enough to keep up. And you kind of saw how that played out, even though after we had a really poor engagement and a really poor fight pushing up the third base, which, again, was a complete mistake. Even though we had that really poor trade, because of our economic advantage, it didn't really matter. We actually made it more than up for that by expanding really aggressively. And this game kind of plays out in the same way, where the Terran player doesn't really want to fall behind economically, and so they try and take the fourth base. But once they try and take that fourth base, if you're able to do it before the Planetary Fortress is morphed, or even on a map such as this, when the Planetary Fortress is morphed, and then just pushing up into the third base directly and cutting off the production, in either situation, it's so much easier for you to actually break the Terran opponent. And that's exactly where this kind of army composition would excel, particularly with just the rapid reinforcement of the warp prison, because again, as opposed to a disruptor composition, and I hate to keep drawing this comparison, but for me this is a really crucial thing, because a lot of people want to talk about how important disruptors are in PvT, whereas I feel like it's actually not the optimal way of playing. Is having such a high gateway count in this game, in this instance we only had 10, we actually could have afforded a little bit more if you look at our income. Being able to reinforce very quickly with warp prism across the map and counter push with our wholly effective force is such a nice position to be in. Again, because we could neither fourth base of the Terran player. How does this composition deal with Liberators? So one thing about this composition is in the early and mid game, against early Liberator pushes, it's actually really easy to defend. If you're not in any other way behind. If you're behind, of course it's going to be difficult to defend a Liberator push, but if we're talking about an even game, an otherwise even game with Liberators coming out, it's pretty reasonable defense. Because you have Storm, which allow you to zone out the bio the same way a Disruptor would, and then blink under with Stalkers, and charge in with Zealots to keep the Stalkers defensed. God, that was a horrible sentence, wasn't it? Let me try doing that again. So the way that you would deal with Liberator pushes going for Disruptors is you'd use the Disruptor shots to zone out the bio, make them run away from under the Liberators, and then push in and focus on the Liberators with your Blink Stalkers. The Psionic Storm plays out almost defended. The Psionic Storm plays out almost the exact same way, in that you can storm the bio, they're going to pull themselves out of the Psionic Storm. If they don't, they're just going to lose the fight anyway. They pull themselves out of the Psionic Storm, and then you push up with your Charge Zealots, you push up with your Blink Stalkers, and you go ahead and actually push them back and snipe. Oh god, the chat. I wish you guys could see this on the over.